Hello students, today we will talk about the advantages and disadvantages, or you can say useful and harmful activities of the bacteria. Then I will teach you the topic about Archaebacteria also. As you know, we are studying Kingdom Monera. In Kingdom Monera, I taught you about the general characteristics of the Monera. The Monera includes bacteria and cyanobacteria. Bacteria already I have been taught. But one more topic in the bacteria I will teach you, a special type of bacteria about the Archaebacteria also. Then I will teach you the cyanobacteria. After Monera, then we will start Kingdom Protista. So in the last lesson, I was teaching you about the bacteria, their cell structure, the mode of reproduction, and I had given a brief introduction about their useful and harmful activities also. But today we will discuss a little bit detail about the bacteria. The usage of the bacteria, they are the natural scavenger. As you know, whatsoever the waste materials we throw outside in our surrounding, all the dead remains of the plants and animals, they are decomposed by the action of the bacteria, by the action of the fungus, and finally the dead remains of the plants and animals, they are converted into the simpler form. And thus you can say that bacteria, they help in the process of recycling of the matters. If the bacteria will be not there in our surrounding, the earth will full with the dead remains of the plants as well as animals. Therefore, they are helpful to clean our surroundings, our environment, and they help in the process of recycling of the matter. The bacteria, they are also helpful in the proper disposal of the wastage. As you know, through the sewage, so many organic waste materials are removed from our houses. The waste materials contain a lot of organic materials, the human feces, and these waste materials which are going to be removed in the form of the sewage, they are also going to be treated by the bacteria. Nitrogen fixation. Bacteria, they are helpful to fix atmospheric nitrogen. As you know, 78 to 79% nitrogen present in our surrounding, and all the plants, they need nitrogen in the form of the nitrogenous compound, either in the form of nitrite or nitrate or ammonium compound. And the nitrogen, the atmospheric nitrogen, the gaseous nitrogen is converted into the form of the nitrogenous compounds with the help of the bacteria. Some of the bacteria, they are free living bacteria like Azotobacter, Pseudomonas. These are the free living bacteria. Rhizobium, as you are studying from the beginning, the rhizobium is a nitrogen fixing symbiotic bacteria which is associated with the root nodules of the leguminous plant, and it fixes nitrogen into the leguminous crop. So bacteria, they are the important nitrogen fixers, you can say, and they help to fix atmospheric nitrogen into the nitrogenous compounds. Fermentation, bacteria help in the process of fermentation also. The conversion of milk into the curd takes place in the presence of bacteria, namely lactobacillus. The production of acetic acid, that is vinegar, from the sugar takes place in the presence of acetobacter acetyl. So many bacteria are there and they help in the process of fermentation, and these products are very, very useful for us. Antibiotics production, bacteria, they help in the production of antibiotics also. As you know, antibiotics are the drugs which are isolated from the useful microorganisms to kill other harmful microorganisms. So bacteria is the source of antibiotics also. For example, streptomycin, it's a very popular antibiotic which is isolated from a bacterium, namely Streptomyces griseus. Ampicillin, tetracycline, chloromycetin, streptomycin. So many antibiotics in the field of the medicine we have been isolated, extracted from the bacteria. So bacteria, they are useful for the human beings, but not all the bacteria they are useful for us. Some of the bacteria, they are harmful also. They are the cause of so many diseases in plants, animals, as well as in human beings. Diseases in plants, I am not giving you here the list. Already you have studied in class 9 about so many bacteria, harmful bacteria. But in the plants like citrus canker, it is a kind of disease which takes place in so many plants, citrus plants like lemons. And this disease is called citrus canker. This disease is caused by a bacteria. The name of this bacteria is Xanthomonas citrate. The same like the blights disease also. Some of the blights in the case of the wheat, rice, in some of the cereals, the spots, they appear on the leaf, and overall the photosynthetic rate is decreased into the plants. The productivity is reduced due to the blight diseases in the plants. Crown gall, this is also a disease in which so many tumor-like structures are formed on the roots of the plant, and this is called crown gall disease. Generally it takes place by a bacterium, namely Agrobacterium tumefaciens. So these are the plant diseases. The same like the diseases in animals, there is a particular disease that is called anthrax in cattle, and in human beings also the bacteria is a cause of so many diseases like tuberculosis, cholera, diphtheria. So many harmful diseases are due to the bacteria. So overall, these are the importance of the bacteria, and these are the harmful activities of the bacteria. Now let us start the second one, that is Archaebacteria. Archaebacteria is a very ancient, or you can say the primitive bacteria. It is considered that Archaebacteria, they might have been evolved through a separate line that was totally separated from the eubacteria, or you can say the normal bacteria. The Archaebacteria are very most primitive prokaryotes are, you can say, very ancient. Prokaryotes and archaebacteria, they are present in a very harsh, or you can say, stressed environmental conditions, where temperature is too much, where acidic medium is there, where too much salts are there. Means the group of the archaebacteria, they are found into a very stressful, you can say, conditions. Generally, the normal bacteria, they do not found in these harsh environmental conditions. The archaebacteria, they don't have the peptidoglycan, the cell wall. As you know, the normal bacteria, they are also known as eubacteria. You have already studied. The normal bacteria, their cell wall is present, is made up of peptidoglycan. But the cell wall of the archaebacteria, they don't have the peptidoglycan. And the cell wall is made up of non-cellulogic polysaccharide and proteins. Means the polysaccharide is there, and which is the polysaccharide combines with the protein to form the cell wall. So these are the features of the archaebacteria. The first, the archaebacteria are the oldest, or you can say very primitive, or you can say very ancient prokaryotes, and they are found where? Into a very harsh, or you can say into a very stressful environmental conditions, and the cell wall is not made up of peptidoglycan like the normal bacteria. Their cell wall lacks peptidoglycan, and the cell wall of the archaebacteria, they are made up of the non-cellulogic polysaccharide along with the proteins. The types of the archaebacteria. The archaebacteria is divided into three parts. These are methanogens, halophiles, and the third one is the thermoacidophiles. All the three headings, all the three types of archaebacteria are given in your NCERT book also. So please look here. Methanogens. The methanogens are the group of the bacteria, they are responsible for the production of methane. Generally, the methanogens, they are present into the rumen, or you can say in the ruminants, into the cattle, in their intestine, in their gut, and they help in the digestion of the food containing cellulose. And overall, the methanogens, they are responsible for the production of methane. One example I have written here, methanobacterium. They are found, as I told you, into gut of the ruminants like cows, buffaloes, sheep, and other herbivores. They help in the production of methane. You can remember in class 10th I taught you, in biogas production, when the animal dung is used for the methane production, the dung, naturally it contains this bacteria, methanobacterium, and this bacteria is helpful in the production of methane gas. Now the second one is the halophiles. Halophiles, they are found into a very salt, into the condition where the salt is too much. Like halobacterium, it's a very good example of halophiles. They are present into the medium where salt concentration is too much. The third one is the thermoacidophiles. The thermoacidophiles, as the name indicates, thermo means temperature, and acidophiles acidic medium. Thermoacidophiles bacteria, they are found into the condition where temperature is too much and the pH is very low. That is, in high temperature condition where temperature is too much and where the condition, the acidic environment is too much, means generally they adopt into the pH that is 2 to 7 in the acidic medium, and the temperature generally it goes more than 90 degrees Celsius. So thermoacidophiles, they can adopt themselves into extreme temperature, high temperature, and into the extreme pH also, low pH also. Generally the pH ranges from 2, 3, 4 up to 5, 6, but they can adopt a very low pH. So these three bacteria are there, methanogens, found into the gut of the ruminants. They are helpful in the production of methane gas. Halophiles, they are found into the condition where salt condition is too much. And the thermoacidophiles, these bacteria, archaebacteria, they can adapt themselves into a very high, or you can say extreme temperature, as well as at a very low pH also. So that's all about archaebacteria. Now let us start with the cyanobacteria. These all headings are included into the kingdom Monera only. Cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria, they are also known as blue-green algae. The cyanobacteria, they are also the prokaryotic in nature. Their body structure is almost same as the structure of the bacteria. But in cyanobacteria, cell wall is not made up of peptidoglycan. In cyanobacteria, the cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan, and the cyanobacteria, this one is the cell wall. And just above to the cell wall, one more layer is there in the case of cyanobacteria. And this layer is called mucilaginous. Mucilaginous sheath. Mucilaginous sheath means it is made up of a very viscous, slimy layer that is mucilage, which is sticky in nature. This mucilaginous cover is followed by the cell wall, which is made up of peptidoglycan. Then the cell wall is followed by plasma membrane. You can write here plasma. This is the structure of the cyanobacterial cell. Plasma membrane. In this cell also, the nucleus is not well developed. The nucleus is called nuclei. This portion you can make it cytoplasm. The cytoplasm contains so many chromatophores, the photosynthetic lamellae. You can note down here chromatophores. And you know chromatophores are found in the bacteria also, in prokaryotic cell. Like bacteria also, the chromatophores are the photosynthetic lamellae. The membranous structure, they contain the photosynthetic pigments. They help in the process of photosynthesis. But here it's very, very important. In the bacteria, the main chlorophyll pigment is called bacteriochlorophyll. In bacteria, the name of the chlorophyll is called bacteriochlorophyll. But here in cyanobacteria, a special type of chlorophyll that is called chlorophyll A is found. And apart from chlorophyll A, some other pigments are also found. And these pigments are phycocyanin and phycoerythrin. All the cyanobacteria, it is very, very important. All the cyanobacteria, they are photosynthetic in nature. Means they do the process of photosynthesis, and during the process of photosynthesis, they evolve oxygen. Let me to differentiate, first of all, in between bacteria and cyanobacteria. Because I have already taught about the bacteria, and now I am teaching you the cyanobacteria. So first you see, what are the differences between bacteria and cyanobacteria? The bacteria, the size of the bacterial cell is smaller, while the size of the cyanobacteria, they are larger in size. The bacteria, they are unicellular in nature. Their body is made up of a single cell. All the bacteria, the eubacteria, they are made up of a single cell. They are unicellular in nature. But cyanobacteria, they may be unicellular, or their body may be the filamentous, they may be the multicellular. Some of the bacteria like Nostoc, Enabina, Oscillatoria, their body is filamentous. The bacteria, they may be autotrophs or may be heterotrophs. As I told you, some of the bacteria, they can synthesize their own food by the process of photosynthesis or by the process of chemosynthesis. While some of the bacteria, they are heterotrophs. So bacteria may be autotrophs or may be heterotrophs, but cyanobacteria, all the cyanobacteria, they are autotrophs. Means they do photosynthesis and they can prepare their own food materials. The bacteria may be flagellated. They may have the flagella, but in the case of cyanobacteria, the flagella are not found. The bacteria, they are anoxygenic. Means when the bacteria, they perform the process of photosynthesis, they do not evolve oxygen as a byproduct. But it's very, very important, the cyanobacteria like Nostoc, Enabina, Oscillatoria, all these cyanobacteria, they evolve oxygen. They are oxygenic. Bacteria, they are cosmopolitan in nature also. As I told you earlier, that the bacteria may be present in the air, water, soil, but cyanobacteria, they are mainly adapted to the aquatic life in the pond, lake, river. They need the moisture content, water, where they grow. So these are the differences in bacteria and cyanobacteria. I request you all to note down the topics which I have discussed here in a separate notebook, also in the tabular form. You are studying all the things like bacteria, cyanobacteria, archaebacteria. You correlate in all the organisms, and just you remember that what kind of differences are there in the different groups of the organisms. Some of the one diagram is there in the NCERT book about the Oscillatoria, Nostoc. The body of the Nostoc, this is a type of cyanobacteria, is filamentous. You can see here, this is the filamentous structure. So many cells, they are arranged one above. This is the filamentous form, this is the multicellular filamentous form. A particular cell may be adopted for the nitrogen fixation and this cell is called heterocyst. So heterocyst is found, this is also very very important, heterocyst is found in some of the cyanobacteria, and the heterocyst is a specialized cell in Nosta or in some of the other cyanobacteria, and they help in the process of nitrogen fixation. So cyanobacteria, they help in the process of nitrogen fixation. But overall, why bacteria and cyanobacteria, both they have been kept into the kingdom Monera? Because the nature of the cell is prokaryotic. Most of the cell organelles are absent. There is no mitochondria, no endoplasmic reticulum, no Golgi apparatus, nucleus here in the case of cyanobacteria is also not well developed. So because of so many similarities in both bacteria and cyanobacteria, both they have been kept into the kingdom Monera. But so many differences are also there, I have already discussed, and you have to learn all these differences. About the photosynthetic pigment, as I told you, in the case of bacteria, the name of the photosynthetic pigment is bacteriochlorophyll. But here, a special type of pigment is found, that is called chlorophyll A, phycocyanin and phycoerythrin. So almost the cellular structure is same. Now, what are the uses of the cyanobacteria? The first, cyanobacteria. The cyanobacteria, they help in the process of nitrogen fixation. As I told you, the heterocyst, like in the case of Nosta, is a specialized cell. It has ability, the capability to fix atmospheric nitrogen into the form of nitrogenous compound. So you can say that the cyanobacteria is helpful in the process of nitrogen fixation. Some of the cyanobacteria like Enabina, they are helpful. Some of the cyanobacteria are helpful to prevent soil erosion. As you know, soil erosion is the process of the removal of the topsoil. When the cyanobacteria, they are present, they can prevent the loss of the soil. It means they are helpful in the process of the prevention of the soil, the top level of the soil. Some of the cyanobacteria, especially spirulina, it is also known as SCP, single cell protein. It is microscopic in nature, but the spirulina, it is a single cell in its structure, it is unicellular in nature, but it contains a huge amount of the proteins. The protein content is too much, SCP, and the SCP, single cell protein, it is the source of protein diet. Some of the space travelers, they take spirulina because the size is very less, and as per size is concerned, the protein content is too much. So they are the source of the food material also. So overall, the cyanobacteria, they are helpful in the nitrogen fixation. The cyanobacteria, they prevent soil erosion. The cyanobacteria, they are the source of the food also. They are known as SCP, single cell protein, like the spirulina. But apart from the useful activities, the cyanobacteria, they are harmful also. The cyanobacteria, they may be the cause of the algal bloom. They can deplete, they can reduce the amount of dissolved oxygen into the water, and therefore the BOD gets very high. and due to the high BOD, high biological oxygen demand, due to the depletion of the oxygen, the fish mortality and other aquatic life is going to be disturbed. You can see in all the polluted water, where the pollution is too much, the water which contains a lot of nitrogenous fertilizers, also that amount of dissolved oxygen gradually decreases and BOD gets high. When the water is highly contaminated, it supports the growth of algae, especially the cyanobacteria. They flourish too much, they grow too much, and it causes algal bloom. The further algal bloom causes the depletion of oxygen, the BOD, it becomes high and it disturbs whole the aquatic life. So this is the disadvantage of cyanobacteria. So that's all for today, and tomorrow I will start the next topic, the next kingdom, that is protista. Before I close this lesson, you please note down some of the questions from the kingdom Monera and from five kingdom system of classification. Please note down. Name all the kingdoms. Name all the kingdoms as per five kingdom system of classification. Name all the kingdoms as per five kingdom system of classification. Question number two. Write the criteria to classify. Write the criteria to classify organisms as per five kingdom system of classification. Question number three. Characteristics of kingdom Monera. Write the general characteristics of the kingdom Monera. Next, write the differences between bacteria and cyanobacteria. Write the differences between bacteria and cyanobacteria. And the last question is, what is archaebacteria? Name all the types of archaebacteria. So that's all for today, and I hope you are completing the assignments which we are giving here daily. I hope that you have made a separate notebook for this subject also. Whenever you will come back to this school, I will go through your notes. I will check thoroughly whether all these assignments you have been completed thoroughly or not. So that's all. Thanks. Thank you so much.